Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 51st session of the online Optom learning series. So today we have Dr. Urmisha. She is a cataract surgeon and a medical retina specialist. She completed her MBBS at the prestigious Seth GS Medical College and KEM Hospital in Mumbai, and then went on to do her master's in ophthalmology at St. John's Medical College and Hospital, Bangalore. When she returned to Bombay, she worked as an associate ophthalmologist at Drushti Eye and Retina Center, where she received training in medical treatment of various retinal disorders. She is a highly skilled clinician, providing her patient with very spot-on diagnosis and treatment, and she is also very well-versed with the management of various retinal diseases, naming a few such as diabetic retinopathy, retinal vein occlusions, age-related macular degenerations, and CSR, which is central serous retinopathy. Other than retinal conditions, she also has a great expertise in managing general ophthalmological problems such as eyelid problems, eye infections, dry eye diseases, uveitis, and glaucoma. And today, Dr. Urmi is going to talk to us about how do we go about interpreting the macular OCT, and she's going to try to make it easy for us in interpreting the macular OCT. So thank you very much, Dr. Urmi. Welcome to the OOLS online learning series. And I will leave the screen time to you now.
Sure. Thank you so much, Fakhruddin, for that very, very kind introduction. Thank you to the organizers for giving me this chance to present on this topic. And thank you to all of you for taking out the time to listen to me. The topic for today, as Fakhruddin has said, is interpreting the macular OCT. I'm going to try and simplify it for all of you. OCT has become an integral part of our ophthalmic practice. As we know, there are different types of OCT, which include the macular OCT, the RNFL OCT, which is used for glaucoma diagnostics, and the anterior segment OCT. Now, for those of you who are in clinical practice, in busy clinics, very often it is the optometrists who are doing the scans. It is very important for you to know how to correctly do the scan and how to correctly interpret what you are seeing on the screen. Now, there might be times when you have seen something like this, where you know it is not normal, but you're not sure exactly what it is. So don't let this leave you perplexed. Interpreting the OCT actually is very easy if you follow a thorough step-by-step approach, which is what I will be taking you all through today. So what is an OCT? OCT basically stands for optical coherence tomography, which enables us to get high resolution cross-sectional images of the retina in a non-invasive manner. And it is similar to ultrasound of other parts of the body. The difference being that ultrasound utilizes sound waves, whereas OCT works by using light waves. A few technical details before we move on to actual interpretation of the OCT. So how the OCT works is that basically it has a source of light which gives out an infrared light, which is split by a beam into two parts. There is a reference arm which gets reflected by a mirror, and there is a sample arm which gets projected onto the retina, and from the retina it gets scattered back from the different layers of the retina. Now those light layers which are scattered back and the reference arm are superimposed and made to produce patterns, which is known as an A-scan. A-scans are captured at adjacent retinal locations and combined to give us a B-scan. Don't worry, all this is just technical details. Okay, it has nothing to do with the actual interpretation of the OCT. Now, this is how your normal OCT is going to look. The dark area above here corresponds to the vitreous. These lines that you can see here, the alternate black and white lines, constitute the retina. And below this, this area here is the choroid. Basically, the black and white areas depend on the reflectivity, that is the ability of the tissue to reflect back light. So in a black and white image, areas which are white are called hyperreflective because they have a high reflectivity, and the darker areas are the lower reflectivity areas. And if you're looking at a color image of the OCT, the blue areas are the ones which correspond to lower reflectivity, and going to almost red is what corresponds to higher reflectivity. We will be discussing all this in detail. OCT was first introduced in 1991, and since then it has undergone a lot of change in the technology that is used to capture the scans. So initially, we had something called as a time domain OCT, which took about 400 A scans per second. That has moved on to the spectral domain OCT, which can give us almost up to 70,000 A scans per second, which gives us a very high resolution and lesser chances of missing lesions or causing artifacts. The spectral domain OCT also has a feature called as the EDI, which is the enhanced depth imaging, which allows us to visualize almost up to the sclera posteriorly. And the newest technology is the swept source OCT, which has an even larger number of A scans, 1 lakh to 4 lakh A scans per second, which uses longer wavelengths. It has a better tissue penetration and allows visualization of the deeper structures even better than the EDI mode of the spectral domain OCT. So how are you going to take an OCT correctly? Ask the patient to place the chin on the chin rest. They will have an internal target which they will be able to see inside, so they need to focus on that. You need to choose which program you are doing, the macula or the RNFL. RNFL, as we discussed, is for glaucoma imaging. So here we will discuss the macula imaging. Make sure when you're taking the OCT that the OCT image is upright and straight, and the reference scan pattern that you have chosen is centered either on the fovea or on whatever is the area of interest. Also, some machines allow you to correct for higher refractive errors. So these are typically the scan protocols available. This is the macular cube, which is most commonly used, which scans the retina in the area outlined by the cube. These are the radial line scan, and this is the raster lines, which normally most machines are either a 5 or 7 line raster. You can center these lines on whichever area you want to image, and it gives you a higher resolution image. Now, the advantages of OCT is that it is non-invasive, it is quick, reproducible, it gives us quantitative measurements. So even if we can see the swelling on the retina, on the fundus IDO, but on the OCT, it allows us to actually measure how much is the retinal thickness. And it is used for the diagnosis and follow-up of a number of different retinal conditions. The two main limitations are that it needs a pupil diameter of 3 millimeter or more, and it needs clear media. So that means if you have a very small pupil, you will not be able to take the scan. And if there are media opacities, like dense cataracts, vitreous hemorrhages, or corneal opacities, those will interfere with the clarity of the image. And in case of dense cataracts or vitreous hemorrhages, if you need to visualize the posterior segment, then doing a B scan will be better than doing an OCT. So before we come to interpreting the OCT, let us quickly run through the retina layers so that we know what we are looking at. Now, as we know, the retina typically has 10 layers. Okay, out of these, there are 3 layers which are composed of cells. This is the layer of photoreceptors, which are the cells which convert the incident light into electrical energy. The cell bodies of these form the outer nuclear layer. Then up here, we have the ganglion cell layers, the axons of which form the optic nerve. And in between these two, we have the supporting cells of the retina, the Müller cells, bipolar cells, and amacrine cells. And these form the inner nuclear layer. The junctions between the ganglion cell layer and inner nuclear forms the inner plexiform layer. And junction between the outer nuclear and inner nuclear forms the outer plexiform layer. Below the photoreceptors is the retinal pigment epithelium. And above the nerve fiber layer is the internal limiting membrane of the retina. So how does this look on the OCT? As we discussed earlier, OCT has all these alternate layers of dark and light. Starting from the top, this is the vitreous, which is optically clear, so it appears as black. Below that is the internal limiting and the retinal nerve fiber layer, which are white. An easy way to remember is that the 3 nuclear layers are going to appear hyporeflective, that is, they are going to be appearing as dark layers. And all the other layers which have membranes or the plexiform layers are going to appear hyperreflective or white. So here, this thick layer that we can see is the outer nuclear layer corresponding to this layer here. Above that, the next black band is the inner nuclear layer corresponding to this layer of bipolar cells and amacrine cells. And above that, you have a very thin black layer which corresponds to the ganglion cell layer, which is this. In between these two blacks is this white, which is the inner plexiform layer here. And in between these two blacks is this white, which is the outer plexiform layer. Below the outer nuclear layer, you have 4 white lines, which correspond to the external limiting membrane. the layer of the photoreceptors and the junction of the inner segment and outer segment, which is here. And finally, at the bottom, the pigment epithelium or the RPE and the Bruch's membrane. As we know, in the fovea, the inner retinal layers become very thin and the area is occupied mainly by the photoreceptors, which is what we can see here, that we have the foveal depression. And it is mainly the photoreceptors which are occupying the fovea, which is this black zone here. And this is mainly made up of the cones. Also, as we have the inner and outer segments of the cones here, the segments of the cones are slightly larger than the rods. And since the fovea has mainly the cones, that is why this area is slightly larger here. These are all normal features of the OCT. Also, to know that the layer between the vitreous and the retina, this junction here is called the vitreo-retinal interface. And as we come down to the choroid, this is known as the choroidoscleral junction, because all these terms will come up in our talk. This is something normally that we see on OCTs. This is a shadowing effect that we see due to blood vessels, because there are blood vessels running through the retina. And wherever there is a blood vessel, you will see a hyperreflective area like this with some shadowing behind. So if you ever emit something like this, don't worry, this is a normal thing. Now coming to interpreting the actual OCT changes. I would like to typically divide the changes we see on OCT into three groups. This is a normal OCT. Now the changes that you're seeing could be either due to something happening here at the vitreo-retinal interface, something like this, as you can see the retina is getting pulled up, or the changes can occur here at the RPE and Bruch's membrane between the retina and the choroid, as we can see here, or the changes can occur typically within the surface of the retina with a normal vitreo-retinal interface and a normal RPE and choroid, as we can see here. All of these conditions I will be elaborating soon. Also, it is important to understand the different compartments of the retina where fluid collection can happen. So if the fluid collection is typically within the retina, it is called as intraretinal. Here we can see that there is no fluid in the retina, but it is below the retina. However, the RPE and Bruch's membrane are intact. So this fluid is called as subretinal, where it is between the neurosensory retina and the retinal pigment epithelium. And here, this fluid collection here is sub-RPE, where we can see even the RPE is elevated, as opposed to this where the RPE is intact. And this fluid collection is occurring in the sub-RPE space. Typically, what we are seeing in the OCT is changes in the reflectivity. As we discussed earlier, that the OCT has alternate layers of hyper and hyporeflective areas. So any abnormalities also which occur are going to cause changes in the reflectivity in the OCT. The only thing that causes a decrease in the reflectivity or hyporeflective areas is presence of fluid. As shown earlier, this fluid can occur in different compartments, but basically fluid occurring anywhere is going to cause appearance of these black spaces, as we can see here. As for an increase in the reflectivity, hyperreflectivity is caused by a number of different conditions. We can have deposits here, as we see in hard exudates. You can have membrane formation here, as we see in epiretinal membranes. Or even a hemorrhage, a retinal hemorrhage, can cause an increase in the reflectivity with the shadowing. Again, I will be elaborating on all these soon. Coming to the common retinal conditions that you are likely to see while doing an OCT. The first I would like to elaborate on is OCT changes that we see in ARMD, which is age-related macular degeneration. As we know, AMD is typically of two types. One is the dry variant and one is the wet or the neovascular AMD. In dry AMD, on OCT, you will typically be able to see drusen and geographic atrophy. In wet AMD, we will be able to see the choroidal neovascular membranes, pigment epithelial detachments, and disciform scarring. Let us start with drusen, the simplest of the lot. So what are drusen? They're basically accumulation of the extracellular lipofuscin containing debris. These are the changes that are happening in the retina as the retina ages. And we can see here on both these fundus photos that we can see the drusen here. How this appears on the OCT is basically lumps occurring underneath the RPE. So where the RPE should be straight, instead of that, it is thrown into irregularities. This is because of the drusen occurring at this layer. As dry AMD progresses, it results in something called as geographic atrophy. Geographic atrophy is basically areas where the retina has started to undergo atrophy or thinning out, and below those areas of atrophy, we are able to see the choroid, as we can see here with the choroidal vasculature seen well, and the retinal layers on top of it are absent. How does this appear on OCT? Basically, as the retinal layers on top have atrophied, the light beam coming from the OCT is able to penetrate much better to the choroid, and the choroid has a higher reflectivity. So therefore, this area corresponding to the geographic atrophy is giving us an area of highly reflective choroid as seen here. And in this area, above the choroid, we can see that the retinal layers are atrophied. Coming to the choroidal neovascular membranes. These are one of the commonest things that you might see when you're looking at OCTs. And therefore, it's very important to know how CNVMs can appear on the OCTs. So what is a CNVM? A CNVM stands for choroidal neovascular membrane. It is basically growth of new blood vessels which originate from the choroid, and they are growing upwards through breaks in the Bruch's membrane. So this is how it appears. These are the choroidal vessels. This is your normal retina here. And because of this abnormal growth of blood vessels, they occupy this space between the Bruch's membrane and the retinal pigment epithelium and cause subsequent changes in the retina. How does a CNVM appear on OCT? It is basically a heterogeneous hyperreflective tissue. Hyperreflective means that there's an increased reflectivity, and heterogeneous means the signals are kind of mixed of light and dark. The shape, it could be a dome-shaped, fusiform or nodular, and generally it is always associated with some amount of retinal edema if the membrane is active because of the exudation. So as we can see here, this occurring here is the choroidal neovascular membrane, and around that, these dark spaces that we see is all the fluid or the exudation which is occurring from this membrane. Now the CNVMs on OCT can be divided into three types. The first type, which commonly occurs in AMD, is the type that occurs below the retinal pigment epithelium. So we can see this is the line of the RPE which has been pushed upwards, and below the RPE we see this growth of CNVM here. So this typically occurs in AMD. The second type of CNV occurs in the space, subretinal space, which we discussed earlier, that is above the RPE, between the retinal pigment epithelium and the retina. This occurs in condition where there is some localized damage to the pigment epithelium and Bruch's membrane complex in different retinal conditions, such as pathological myopia with lacquer cracks, multifocal choroiditis, or choroidal rupture. So any of these conditions which is causing a defect in the retina allows the blood vessels to form between the neurosensory retina and the RPE. And the third type of CNV is also something that occurs in AMD, but in this, the blood vessels originally start from the intraretinal space, then they go subretinal, and finally sub-RPE proliferation. This occurs in something called as RAP lesions seen in AMD. Coming to the second common thing that we see in AMD on OCT, which is pigment epithelial detachment. So basically, anything which causes an elevation of the pigment epithelium like this is referred to as a pigment epithelial detachment. The contents of the PED is something that varies, and based on that, there are four types of PED which are described. So basically, this is separation of the RPE from the Bruch's membrane. So there's proliferation in the sub-RPE space. The PED can either be serous, where it is just containing clear fluid. That's why it is appearing as hyporeflective or dark. And there's a complete shadowing of the underlying structures. We cannot see what is below that. Or the PED can be drusenoid, where, as we discussed earlier, the drusen, as they are coalescing and enlarging, they can actually cause a drusenoid PED, that they're causing a detachment of the pigment epithelium. In this case, the PED is filled with homogeneous material, that is similar looking material. A fibrovascular PED is the term given when there is this pigment epithelial detachment occurring in association with a CNVM. So as we said earlier, it's a highly reflective heterogeneous material. And if the PED is filled up with blood, then it is called a hemorrhagic PED, where again blood causes hyperreflectivity with the shadowing of the structures below. The end process of a wet AMD is to result in a disciform scar. A disciform scar is going to look like this on the fundus imaging. And on OCT, what we see is that the entire retinal tissue is replaced by this scar tissue. So OCT shows presence of this hyperreflective fibrotic nodular area, and we cannot make out any layers of the retina or the choroid. This entire thing is replaced by scar, and this is called as a disciform scar in the end stage of neovascular AMD. So what are the uses of OCT in AMD? Firstly, to correctly identify the pathology, that is to correctly localize where is the neovascular membrane, in which layer it is present. We can see the presence of fluid, as we saw earlier, which indicates that yes, this membrane is active. And the main thing is we can monitor the response to treatment. As we know that CNVMs are typically treated by anti-VEGF agents, and to follow up how whether the agent is working or not and how the membranes are regressing, OCT is very helpful. So this is just one image to show the OCT imaging over 12 months, where here we can see the PED and we can see presence of fluid and the CNVMs, which has all over time regressed with the treatment. Coming to the second group of disorders, which I had discussed, which is disorders of the vitromacular or the vitroretinal interface. So here all the changes are going to be happening at the top of the OCT, with the bottom layer of the OCT more or less okay. So what this encompasses is an incomplete posterior vitreous detachment. Now, as we know, the vitreous is normally adherent to the retina, but over time or due to a number of different conditions, it undergoes separation. If this PVD, which is called as a PVD, that is posterior vitreous detachment. Now, if this PVD is incomplete, that means it is still attached to the retina at some place, and there is a very strong adherence of this vitreous to the macula, and because of that, it is exerting some traction. That is, it is pulling up on the macula at this adherent site. Then it will result in some disorders of the vitromacular interface. The first thing is something called as simply vitromacular adhesion, where the vitreous has started to separate, as we can see here. Normally, the vitreous is not seen as a separate layer, but here, because it has detached from the retina, we can see these two lines indicating the vitreous, but it is still adherent to the fovea. It is attached to the fovea within 3 millimeters, but it is not producing any changes in the contour or the shape of the retina. So this is simply that the vitreous is attached here, which means a vitromacular adhesion. When the same vitromacular adhesion starts producing changes in the retina, that means it is here now pulling the retina up. It can result in formation of cystic spaces or fluid or a combination of this. It is called as vitromacular traction. At the same time, the rest of the layers of the retina are still intact, and this is called as vitromacular traction. Moving on to macular holes. Macular holes are basically when there is a defect in the retinal layers. These are of two types, full thickness and lamellar. In full thickness macular holes, there is complete absence of all the layers of the retina, starting from the internal limiting membrane up to the RPE. Whereas in a lamellar hole is also called a partial thickness hole, there is a change in the contour of the retina with a defect in some layers, but typically the photoreceptors are intact at the base. If we remember, this was the layer of our rods and cones, so this layer is intact at the base. Now this is also something you might see pretty often. It is something called as an epiretinal membrane. Epiretinal membranes are basically avascular fibrous membranes that are proliferating on the surface of the retina. And how does it look on OCT? It appears as this hyperreflective, so white area, which is attached to the upper surface of the OCT. These membranes over time also start exerting traction on the retina, pulling on the retina. So there is an absence of the foveal depression. The normal depression is absent. The inner retina is thrown into folds, as we can see here. And if this membrane keeps exerting its traction, it can lead to formation of further cystic spaces or even lamellar or full thickness macular holes. Just to show you the difference between an epiretinal membrane and vitromacular traction, in ERMs, as we said, the inner retina is thrown into folds, and the membrane is adherent to the retina at a lot of places. Whereas in vitromacular traction, the vitreous has neatly separated from the retina, but it is just adherent at the fovea, which it is pulling up, causing the vitromacular traction. Again, OCT can help to document the series of changes happening in a retina over time. So as we can see, starting from here, this has started off as a vitromacular adhesion, which has gone on to produce traction, which has gone on to an impending hole. This is almost likely to become a hole, and it has progressed to become a full thickness macular hole. So an OCT can very nicely help to document all of these changes that are occurring. So how is OCT useful in these disorders of vitromacular traction and membranes? First of all, it helps to correctly identify the pathology, because if there are very fine membranes or subtle vitromacular traction, it might not be seen very easily in the retina, but on the OCT, it can very clearly document it. It helps us to plan for vitreoretinal surgery, depending on the changes that are occurring. And it also helps to monitor the retina structure post-surgery. As we can see here, this was a full thickness macular hole, which has been successfully operated upon, and the hole has closed. So all these changes can be well documented on the OCT. Now coming to the third group of conditions that I had spoken about, where the changes are mainly happening within the retina with a normal vitreous and a normal choroid. This image is typically called as a cystoid macular edema. The common causes of this are diabetic retinopathy, vein occlusions, uveitis, and pseudophakic CME. Now this is a typical fundus picture of a diabetic retinopathy, which shows us retinal hemorrhages, hard exudates, some degree of retinal thickening. So these changes are well seen on OCT, where we can see that there is an increase in the retinal thickness. There are presence of these hyporeflective or black spots indicating fluid. There is subretinal fluid seen here. And we can also see these white spots seen all over, which are the hyperreflective spots corresponding to these hard exudates. OCT also helps us to differentiate between center-involving and non-center-involving DME. In center-involving, the edema is involving the fovea, and in non-center-involving, the edema has spared the fovea, it is here on the side. And this helps us to plan the appropriate treatment. Just a point to differentiate between hard exudates and drusen, because sometimes hard exudates and hard drusen appear very similar on the retina as yellow refractile spots. But on OCT, we can clearly differentiate, because hard exudates appear as deposits, hyperreflective spots within the retina, whereas drusen are basically accumulations beneath the RPE, where the RPE is thrown into these irregularities and the retina otherwise above that is normal. The other causes of CME include venous occlusions. This is a central vein occlusion. This is a branch retinal vein occlusion, where we can see all this fluid present here. And there are no hard exudates seen, as we had seen in diabetic retinopathy. This is a pseudophakic CME. That means the cystoid macular edema that occurs post cataract surgery. We can nicely see these cystic spaces here, which have resolved after treatment. So how is the OCT useful in cases of CME? First of all, it helps to diagnose the cause of reduced vision. Sometimes post cataract surgery, when the patient has a little blurring vision, or in cases of uveitis, where you're not sure what the cause of reduced vision is, doing an OCT will help to show that yes, there is the fluid, there is cystoid macular edema, which needs to be treated. It helps to quantify the amount of edema. It helps us to measure how much is the fluid and see how it is responding to treatment. It helps us to decide the appropriate treatment. As in diabetic retinopathy, you might want to treat using anti-VEGF injections or laser or surgery. So it helps us to take these decisions, and it helps to monitor the response to treatment. As we can see here, the CME has subsided after giving an injection. Coming to a few other conditions in which OCT can be done. This is a central serous retinopathy, where you can see accumulation of fluid in the subretinal space. The retina overlying that is fine, the RPE and choroid are fine, and the fluid is accumulated here. Sometimes a CSR may be associated with a small PED as well, pigment epithelial detachment, as seen here. This is a picture of an arterial occlusion, a central retinal artery occlusion. As we can make out, there is diffuse retinal edema and a cherry red spot seen here. So how this appears on OCT is that there is an increased thickness and reflectivity of the inner layers due to edema and a reduced reflectivity of the outer layers as seen here, which appear darker because of the edema which is blocking the light. This is a branch retinal artery occlusion. What I want to show you is the changes that occur over time. This is the OCT, which this is showing the superior retina and this is showing the inferior retina, superior to inferior here. So because of this edema, as we saw that there is an increased thickness and edema of the retina, but over time, this area of the retina which has not received its blood supply due to the arterial occlusion undergoes atrophy or thinning. So over time, the normal retina, which is the superior retina, looks thicker and the inferior retina will look thinner. So if you ever see something like this on OCT, you should always keep in mind that he might be having an old vascular occlusion. And we discussed the numerous causes of increased thickness of the retina, but there are times when you can even see thinned out retinas, as seen here in a patient of retinitis pigmentosa, where the central retinal thickness is just 139 microns. I'll be discussing the normal values in a bit. This was a patient of proliferative diabetic retinopathy, who showed evidence of fractional detachment superiorly. But when we did the macular OCT, we saw that this fractional detachment is extending up to the fovea, and this helps us take decisions for surgery. So as you can see here, this part is the retina is attached, but here it is beginning to get detached. Now this is an OCT, an image of somebody who was suffering from solar retinopathy, which happens when you look at solar eclipses, where you can see that typically the retinal layers are normal, but you just see a defect here in the layer of photoreceptors just below the fovea, and this results in a reduced visual acuity. So how do you actually go about interpreting the OCT? When you're doing the OCT, you check what is the indication for doing the OCT and does your scan cover that area of interest. We check the quality of the image that you are getting. And once you have taken the scan, you evaluate each layer, starting from the choroidoscleral junction right up to the vitreous. And what are you looking for as you're evaluating this? You're looking for changes in the contour or the shape of the retina, changes in the thickness, changes in reflectivity. Is there any loss of tissue or is there any presence of abnormal tissue? So after having gone through all the different conditions, we can now see that changes in the contour or the shape of the retina will occur if there is any vitromacular traction or epiretinal membranes. Changes in thickness, there will be an increased thickness as occurs in cystoid macular edema, tractions, central serous retinopathy, or any cause of fluid accumulation in the retina. And reduced thickness will occur when there's retinal thinning seen in retinitis pigmentosa or arterial occlusions. Changes in reflectivity, as we said, reduced reflectivity where you have dark spots appearing is typically because of fluid, whereas an increased reflectivity can occur because of hard exudates, hemorrhages, membrane formations, etc. Loss of tissue will occur in macular holes where it could be partial thickness or full thickness, and presence of abnormal tissue occurs when you have the formation of choroidal neovascular membranes. And after you have gone through each layer of the OCT, the next thing you need to do is take the appropriate measurements. So this is a normal retina, a retinal OCT having a normal retinal thickness of about 245 micrometers, whereas this is an OCT of a diabetic patient showing us diabetic macular edema and an increased thickness of 507 micrometers. The retinal thickness is the value in microns, it's the distance between this internal limiting membrane and the RPE, retinal pigment epithelium. Thank you. Also, when you look at an OCT printout, you will see a color map. In a color map, basically the warmer colors indicate thicker areas as we go towards red and white, and the cooler colors indicate thinner areas, these areas of blue and green. And you also see a thickness map. In a thickness map, you have circles of 1 millimeter, 3 millimeter, and 6 millimeters, which are centered on the fovea. And this divides the macula into 9 areas and takes their thicknesses. One common term which is used in measuring the retinal thickness is something known as the central subfield, it's a circular area of 1 millimeter diameter, which is centered around the central point. And this is very useful in monitoring the follow-up of the edema, and also it correlates well with the visual acuity. The normal retinal thickness is typically around 245 microns. Anything above 250 microns, that's getting included in trials as retinal edema. It's also important to know that it is difficult to compare the retinal thickness between OCT machines because the way that the different machines take the thickness differs. All of these machines use this internal limiting membrane as one border, but the other border, because there are four lines here, as we had discussed, which includes the RPE and the photoreceptor zone and the inner segment, outer segment junction. So either of these layers could be taken as the other line for measurement, and thus there could be a difference in the thickness if the same person is imaged on different machines. Hence, if a person is coming to you, it is very important to image on your own machine so that you get the thickness and you can follow up accordingly. Coming to macular change analysis, as we can see here, this was the first visit of the patient and this was the second visit. Now we can see that the edema has increased. But if we want to see exactly how much the edema has increased and how well it is responding to follow up, there are these programs in the machine called as macular change analysis. Like for example here, this patient who came to us in March then underwent an anti-VEGF injection, and we can see that the edema has reduced by this much amount. So always a green will show you a reduction in edema and red will show you an increase in edema. And at this visit, he took the second injection, after which there has been a further reduction in the edema. So this is a very useful feature to monitor how the patient is responding to treatment. Also, the OCT can be used to capture lesions which are not necessarily in the macular region. For example, this patient had, this is the disc, this is the macula here. He had a retinal detachment inferior to the disc. So you can basically place the macular cube over whatever area interests you and then take the scan. And you can see that this is the retinal detachment here. This person had a polyp occurring nasally. This is the disc and the macula would be somewhere here. So this is the nasal polyp which is imaged here. And this was a patient who actually had choroidal metastasis coming from breast cancer. We can see here on the fundus picture these metastatic spots here, which are again well captured on the OCT. And coming finally to the newer advances in OCT, there is something known as OCT angiography, which is becoming very popular. Basically, it is a non-invasive way to image the blood vessels of the retina. Up till now, that was being done only by using the angiographies. But what OCT angiography does is that it uses that same principle of light reflectance on the surface of the moving red blood cells to depict where the vessels are and what are the changes in the vasculature, and thus eliminating the need for putting in dyes. And there is also a good amount of research going on and getting intraoperative OCT, because an intraoperative OCT would give an immediate feedback that can help the surgeon to decide the further maneuvers and confirm the surgical endpoints. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Urmi ma'am. Thank you so much. I think it was a very comprehensive presentation, and the first question is about the thickness. So the thickness of the nerve fiber layer in the OCT is said to increase, you know, when it reaches the optic disc.
Correct.
But although it also helps in identifying which eye it is, can you probably help us to elaborate on the relation of the anatomical structures? How does it normally help that?
Actually, I don't know whether this is really useful for the macular OCT, because you're obviously knowing which eye you're imaging. And typically in macular OCT, we are centering the cube on the fovea. So we are not really going up to the optic disc in a normal macular OCT.
Yeah, because we are more focused at the macular area probably. And then, so that probably answers that. The other question is, how would the OCT be helpful in cases of retinal pseudohole?
So retinal pseudohole is typically formed when there is an epiretinal membrane and there is a hole which is occurring in that membrane. So when you're looking at the retina, when you're looking at the fundus, you can see a hole, but you're not sure where exactly it is. So the OCT will help you to image that the retina is normal, but it is the membrane which is formed on top which has got the hole.
Okay. So if there is a presence of epiretinal membrane, probably it's a pseudo hole. Is that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So let's look at the other question. This is again kind of a practical question, but when it comes to OCT, we have a spectral domain and we have a time domain OCT.
Correct.
So first, I would just add on this question. What's your experience? Yeah. Which one is better in terms of clinical usage? Okay. And does both of them behave differently for diagnosing particular conditions?
Correct. So as we know, spectral domain OCT is the newer technology. And anything which is a newer technology is going to give us much better results. As I had explained in one of my initial few slides, that time domain was the first OCT that was started, which images only about 400 A scans a second, and it only takes the images in 6 radial lines. So there are chances that pathologies in between can get missed. Whereas a spectral domain OCT has a much higher resolution. So unless there is, I mean, most machines now are all spectral domain OCT. I don't think, like only the very older machines would now be having time domain. So there's no real need to use a time domain OCT.
Yeah. So I think more detailed evaluation is possible with a spectral domain OCT,
spectral
because
domain
I think
OCT.
more A scans and more micron thickness is being looked at, right? Yeah.
Correct.
And as you said, definitely most of the newer or the current generations OCTs are based on spectral domain
than
time.
Yes. Correct.
But is there any difference in disease picking up? Will like a time domain?
Definitely a spectral domain will be better.
Better. Because it gives more depth. Yeah.
More depth, more resolution, more A scans. So you're not missing out on any pathology. The clarity of the image itself is much better in a spectral domain versus a time domain.
Okay. And somebody is asking your advice is, please enlighten us on the swept source OCT advantages over the conventional. So this is a newer type of OCT. Any experience on using that?
So basically, again, as the technology gets better, the OCT is going to get better. It's going to have a higher resolution. As I said, that the swept source has a much, it's much better for imaging the deeper layers going up to the choroid and the sclera because it uses longer wavelengths. Yeah. Okay. But again, practically, not everybody has access to a swept source OCT. So these are all theoretical discussions. But what is important for us is that the machine that we have, what is the best we can do with it?
Yeah.
And the normal spectral domain OCTs with the enhanced depth imaging are excellent for imaging.
Yeah. And would radial lines or raster lines be helpful in interpreting any kinds of macular? I suppose this is for macular conditions, but
correct.
What's your take on
that? So basically what happens is that as we center the radial lines or the raster lines can be focused on wherever the pathology is. If there is any particular area that you want to image, which could be at the fovea or just next to the fovea, and it gives you a much higher resolution of that image compared to the macular cube. So in the macular cube, if I have seen that there is, you know, a little defect here or a little swelling here or maybe a doubt of a fluid here, I can take my lines and center it on that image, and that will give me a much more magnified and better resolution image over that area.
Yeah.
So normally, I would always recommend doing a combination of a macular cube and a raster line.
Yeah. So you get much more detail. So the more important thing is, more important thing is you relate it clinically. If you see somewhere near the macula there is a defect, the advantage of raster line is you can take that line there and specifically scan it at that point.
So the thing is, you can even take your cube. You can take your cube anywhere on the retina.
Anywhere.
But the resolution you get in the cube will always be lesser than that you get in the raster line.
The raster line. Yep. So I think it is definitely useful for localized and specifically for that particular lesion area.
Correct.
Yeah. I think that answers the question. A couple of questions before we come to an end. This is about patients with microophthalmos. Can we perform OCT?
So basically in microophthalmos, the eye is going to be a much smaller size. It's like having a hypermetropic eye.
Yeah.
So long as the media is clear, if the cornea is clear, the patient doesn't have a cataract, you can image. But if you have an option in the machine where you can adjust for the refractive error, you can put it towards a higher hypermetropic error so that it is focusing the image a little ahead instead of at the normal point. So that should help you to capture the image.
And does this option, is this option available in in normal OCTs where we can adjust the refractive status?
So I know that some machines have it and some don't. I think you'll have to check the machine that you're using, whether it gives you an option to, because even in high myopes, it is helpful because obviously they won't be wearing the glasses during the OCT.
That's right.
So it is helpful if you can put in the higher myope number or a high hypermetropic number. So you can always check that machine that you're using.
Yep. I think that's let me just tell you this, because somebody asked the procedure of doing an OCT and we skipped that question. Is only because there are so many numerous types of OCT machines available. As you said, you must know the machine, you must get to know the machine. The talk is basically on how to help you diagnose rather than how to perform the test.
Correct. Performing the test is not the test. It's very easy. No, more than easy also, it's very dependent on the machine you're using.
Yep. The more you have to know your machine.
Yeah, the few basic points which I had listed down was common to all the machines, you know, where you put the chin on the chin rest and you ask them to focus on the internal target and you choose which scan you want to do, whether you are doing a macular or an RNFL scan. But beyond that, you know, every machine will have some of its own specifications which you need to do.
Yeah, I think the software and all that would be probably different. So you would have to know your instrument before you, you know, start doing the scans. That's right.
Yes.
So that's why I just took that up and told you that we have skipped that question. You would probably see that on the chat. Let's take one last question. This is about the OCT. How will an OCT look like in an astoid hyalosis conditions?
So basically, again, in this, with an astoid hyalosis, the vitreous, which normally would be clear, instead of that, you'll see all these hyper-reflective spots moving around in the vitreous. Like we said in floaters you might see one or two, but in an astoid hyalosis, again, depending on how dense the astoid hyalosis is, basically, that vitreous which will be clear will not be clear.
Yeah, so you'll see some reflective spots areas moving about on that vitreous.
Yes. Okay. In the vitreous.
Okay. And one last question. This is probably, I would just ask it from my side. Do you think an OCT should be a important or a compulsory test to be done in routine primary eye care practices? Or you think OCT should only be done if you find a problem in while examining the fundus? What do you think about it?
So there are a few things which go which you need to look at altogether. First thing, main thing is the visual acuity. If your vision is 6x6 and N6, and if your retina looks normal, and if the person doesn't have any other comorbidities, then there is no real need to do an OCT. Okay. There is a question that, yes, whether it should be done routinely, preoperatively in cataract surgery. I think that would be very helpful because it helps to give you the visual prognosis. You don't want to have surprises after your surgery and say, oh, why is the vision not improving? Sometimes there could be thin ERMs, there could be a little bit of fluid in diabetic patients. So that is always helpful in preoperatively. Also, whether it should be run routinely in diabetic patients also maybe a little bit of an overkill, because if the retina looks absolutely normal and your vision is 6, 6, N6, then there's no real need to do it.
Yeah.
But in case of the slightest doubt, yes, it is very helpful. And the other thing is also the cost, no? Because practically when we are seeing, when if every patient, if you're asking them to pay so much extra for an OCT, whether that's really justifiable or not, is something we need to figure out.
Yeah, so it probably is not a routine test. It's a special test which you should take up when you see any signs or symptoms, or probably if there is any comorbidity, as you mentioned, you must do an OCT and get ruled out.
Unless if you are offering it free of cost to your patients, you can definitely go ahead.
which I think is not feasible in most of the places. But yeah, if you have if you have an access to it, yes, you should do it for all your patients. But if there's any comorbidity or if you clinically relate anything to the fundus or anything, that's the time you should do it.
Correct. And before I end, Fakhruddin, just one more thing I wanted to specify.
Yes.
The importance of, because they're all optometrists here, the importance of checking the near vision, because very often if there is a little bit of fluid under the macula, it is going to affect your near vision more than the distance vision. So in a lot of places, I have seen that they take the near vision of both eyes together. You know, you open both the eyes and ask them to read. But especially in post-operative patients or diabetic patients, if you take each eye individually and you find that one eye near vision is a little lower than the other eye, that will also give you a clue that there is something going on at the macula and you need to image it
on
the OCT.
So taking near vision would be monocularly is very important.
Monocularly, very important. And every patient at every point.
Every patient, whatever the case may be. And probably an AMSLERS also, I think you would agree to that. Doing an AMSLERS would also give you some clue.
Again, AMSLERS depending, I mean, not required for everybody, no? Only if you have elderly people in whom you're suspecting an ARMD or for all elderly people, yes, but not required for the younger age group.
Yeah. So, I mean, when you have an AMSLERS abnormal, then you would probably want to do an OCT.
Yes. Definitely.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So, these are some tips for optometrists like us where we have to really take care about taking our near vision for the patients uniocularly. And if you have some problems in near vision and or you have some, defects in the AMSLERS testing, OCT would be a very useful tool in looking at the macula very detailedly and picking out, changes. So I think with that, thank you very much, Dr. Urmi. It was a very wonderful session, a good recap of what we have learned. And I was very happy to see all the images which you have put. You know, it's very important to see the clinical picture of the fundus related to the OCT. Sometimes when people talk about OCT, we only see that red and blue areas, red and blue graphs kind of a thing.
Correct.
But to relate it clinically is very, very important. So thank you for doing that. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Fakhruddin, for having me. And I really hope that, that question which came in the beginning, that OCT is intimidating. So I hope that has become a little less intimidating for everybody. And the next time that you look at a printout, maybe I think if you can make a little better sense of it, then I think that will be good.
Yeah. So it's not only when you have to perform OCT, but as you told in the beginning as well, you might be sitting in your practice where people would come up with their reports for probably a second opinion
or something
like that and ask you, what's this? So you can't say that, sorry, I don't have an OCT means I can't, look at the report.
And because OCT is becoming so widespread that, it's very important to learn how to interpret it because you might be faced with a printout at any time and you need to know what's going on there.
What's going on? Yep. I completely agree to that. Yep. So thank you very much, Dr. Urmi, again for taking out this time and taking this session, wonderful session. We do have session tomorrow. Tomorrow we have a session on sports vision, which is at 5:30 in the evening Indian time and 8 p.m. Late evening Malaysian time. So I would be very happy to see you all tomorrow as well. Until then, stay home, stay safe, and see you all again tomorrow. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Fakhruddin. Thank you, everybody. See you.